Let us concentrate on the studio. So remember, we just registered him. I have similarly registered during the tea break. So let me hopefully. So I am registered for all the courses, and this is the first demo course. Now this is what you see here is a course which has already been created. Please note that we have used the facility of the EDX site, which permits me to import a course which I have designed earlier and to export a course, take a dump and import it as another course. So we have taken the EDX 101, which was made available to us, accessible to us by EDX, and exported it into a bundle and imported it, and she has made 4 clones of that course. So this is effectively the EDX course as an introductory course on what the whole thing is about. Notice that this course is organized. So this is what the instructor will see these as. This is the course outline. So there is an introduction. The demo course overview. These are various components. Incidentally, the whole course organization is broken into sections, subsections, units, and subunits. Yeah.
Can we export these courses from other platforms like Moodle or Course Builder
no,
or something?
No.
Only from EDX?
No. Just as you cannot take any other course and import it into Moodle either.
Okay.
Now that's the problem with these individual platforms. Mm-hmm. The easiest they permit you is that from the same platform to another instance of that platform running somewhere else, yeah, you can exchange information. The same thing is true about SWAM.
So can we take some text or ASCII files from there and then we can?
Yeah, you can use any digital material while creating this course.
Okay.
You can take PDF file, you can take text, Word you file. Can take videos.
Okay.
You can insert videos here, upload videos and insert them.
Okay.
And use all digital assets, but a course as a whole, a paper as a whole, cannot be imported from any other platform than the EDX.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah. An important point, so this has not been clarified, the two very fundamental principles and agreements that have been reached and we'll all have to follow. First of all national mission created, funded projects which create knowledge or software, that must go into open source. It must be released under Creative Commons CC BY SA license. That is now a mandate. We follow it even in IIT. EDX site does not necessarily follow it. So all courses, their courses are not open source. EDX 101, they have given us special access for this purpose. So that is effectively open source, but not other courses. However, the courses that you create, every text, every photograph, every video must not be encumbered with IP issues. It is your responsibility and it is the teacher's responsibility to ensure that there is no intellectual property violation that is happening in use of any content that has been deployed in the course. Yes. Yes.
Some software will be provided like Turnitin, etc. for checking the plagiarism.
Yes. No. So you have to make sure that you are not violating anything. For example, I'll tell you something. You take PowerPoint. It's a costed product. But the PowerPoint slides that you create are your own property.
Yeah.
So you can use them. Okay. PDF creation may require an Adobe license. But a PDF file that you create with contents, your own contents, is your property, is not somebody else's property.
Yeah. Did I get it right that this is open source, not just open access?
Yes, that is correct.
Okay.
Every creator will have to give an undertaking.
Yes.
That they have not done.
In fact, I was about to mention this. This is a very serious issue. When IIT Bombay joined the X Consortium, there were large negotiations where EDX as a not-for-profit company requires that every participating institution must indemnify EDX for any IPR violation that may happen through the courses that we offer.
Take undertaking from the author as well as report from Turnitin.
Independent on whether you take undertaking or not, your institution is liable legally to ensure that. IIT Bombay, for example, this is a good point that you have made. It's a serious point, so it's worthwhile spending 5 minutes on it. I'll just tell you the experience that we had with EDX. So IIT Bombay is liable. And in India, such court cases are not many. But globally, particularly in the United States, where I think a major characteristic of that society is everybody sues everybody else for something or the other. So such cases could be very predominant. Now, EDX says that I must be indemnified for unlimited liability. We argued that we cannot ever give unlimited liability thing. We never signed such a thing as a government-funded institute. It took us almost a week-long negotiations day and night to convince them that we will not agree. So we have agreed for an indemnity of up to $100,000. Now, $100,000 is IIT Bombay's liability if it is ever proven that any teacher like Gayatonde or Fatak have plagiarized one page in their entire course from someone else. Now, how do you set aside $100,000? So what our committee decided is that we will buy an insurance, a liability insurance. So we have bought a liability insurance for $100,000, for which the annual premium that we pay is about 1.5 lakhs. How much, Kalpana, we negotiated? 1.25 lakhs. So we pay to New India Assurance 1.25 lakhs every year. We'll keep paying it. And for any expenses for fighting these court battles, including in US or whatever, of course, up to certain limits, we have got this liability insurance. So some legal points will have to be taken care of by the institutions. Equally well, IIT Bombay will initially running the platform on behalf of the national initiative, and subsequently the Section 8 company which Professor Lagu will help set up. Incidentally, for those of you who are familiar with the earlier Section 25, under which not-for-profit companies were registered in India, 2013 it has become Section 8. And with some additional points, but that is the Section 8 company. So this company which will run these operations will require such a commitment from every participating university. Broadly, the larger organization that I have proposed to the ministry is that all such universities which together offer such courses year after year after year will form a loose consortium. That consortium will actually evolve itself in its structure, and it is that consortium which will then deal with this Section 25 company for offering of courses, for arranging revenue shares, whatever in the long term that will happen. Okay. To begin with, there is no revenue because the courses are being offered free. There is no cost because the cost is being borne by the government for the first. So as long as that continues, the only responsibility of an individual university and a teacher is to ensure that IP is their own. We had some small things which I would like to explain. When I display a graph from a textbook in my class, it is considered fair academic use. There's nobody objects to it. If I do the same thing when I am training 10,000 students, that may or may not be considered fair academic use. Assume that it is considered fair academic use. But if I say that these content are now open source and released for free distribution and free modification, then it's most certainly not a fair academic. So it is absolutely mandatory that when I prepare a course, the expression of every slide, every write-up, everything that I do, either it should be my own or it should come from an equivalent open source, which I should be able to quote, saying that this comes from this. So this is an important paradigm.
We will not be able to use textbook, or we can't refer them, or?
You can refer to a textbook provided you cite the reference. But for example, I am using a textbook for the next offering of CS101X, which is written by a colleague of mine, Professor Abhiram Ranade. Now, to their publisher, we wrote specifically saying that if I use it as a textbook, then I will have to quote the following. I will have to use the following from the textbook. A, exercise problems, and B, sample problems which have been worked out in the book. Okay, I will not be using that explanation, but I will be using that for the demonstration. It's a programming course. So, for example, complete programs which Abhiram Ranade has written and which is now an intellectual property of the publisher, I'll be able to use. I have got a specific permission letter from McGraw-Hill Education or whatever, saying yes, you are permitted to do so and you can release this in open source, provided you cite the reference. No. No. It is, we are permitted to release such contents in open source. That means we are permitted to release my lectures under Creative Commons. This permission explicitly has been given by the publisher to us. No, it will not. There is a specific license under Creative Commons called non-commercial. If my Creative Commons license is NC, then and only then the question that you say arises. But if my Creative Commons license is the CC BY, that is by attribution, and SA, that is share alike, then there is absolutely no restriction on its commercial use. It is well established. My colleague, Professor Shishir Jha from School of Management, when I was heading it for a year, I actually initiated some activities. He has taken great initiative to define a Creative Commons license for India, and they have studied all legal aspects. Yes. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
For example, all content created, content by
registration, and also part of that CC BY. No, so that content can be used not only by you but by anybody for commercial purposes. Huh. Yeah, it is commercial, it is perfectly permitted. Yeah, it is perfectly permitted. In fact, that's the whole point of creating an ecosystem. An open source contribution without that NC clause actually helps create an ecosystem. In fact, there were lots of arguments. What if he makes so much money using my material? I had a very clumsy way of putting this feeling across, where I have created a course and you are making money on it. So those of you who understand Hindi will appreciate what we say in Madhya Pradesh, ki Hindustan mein logon ko apne dukh se itna dukh nahi hota, jitna dusron ke sukh se dukh hota. So if others are making money on my effort, I feel more worried than if I don't make any money on my effort. But that is J factor, that is standard. But this is not, once you donate anything to open source, you have to say idam na mama. Then what the world does, including you, is perfectly all right. That is the very basis of Creative Commons license. The point is that if I am a teacher in your university, I have to be told to be very careful on the content that I create. So the media people, for example, when they create courses, in fact, the whole Creative Commons came out of the media thing. I can use it only for 2 seconds, 5 seconds. So we, even in our courses, the images that we use, we actually go to the wiki images or such sites. We examine the license on a photograph or an image. And we take only that that image which is in open source. This increases the amount of work to be done.
So that, if I've understood you right, so the same course, I can use it as a part of my institute's revenue model if there are already running courses. Absolutely. And we are charging fees for that.
In fact, that's the whole idea, that you should be able to offer the courses which are most popular in your own place. Here is a demo course overview. So under this, this is a subsection, right? In this subsection, there is one unit which is introduction video and the sequences. I can see that. So what you see here are different subunits. So this is one subunit which is just a text. Notice that when you create this course, you will essentially be editing this course. The minimum that I would expect you, when you edit this course, I would expect all of you to hit on this welcome to EDX demo course. You will have to say welcome to this SWAYAM demo course. This is the advantage of starting with an existing course which you are modifying. You can modify totally, you can modify it partially, you can modify segments of it. What it means is, and this is the process, by the way, which will be used when you update a course, for example. So I have created a course, I have offered it once. Now I realize by the feedback that I need to add this here, I need to modify this here, there was one mistake in that quiz, etc. I would actually take that course, clone it, create a new course and edit it to make it better. Now this is the exercise which all of you will be doing in the afternoon. So here, for example, I would like to say welcome to SWAYAM demo course introduction. This is where you can explore to take an SWAYAM course like this one. Most courses will have an intro video which shows how it works. Here is an introduction video.
Hi, and welcome to the edX demonstration course. I'm Eric, and I'm here to help you get a better understanding of how fun and easy it is to take an edX course. So let's get started. Let me show you how all the parts work together.
Notice two things. He is speaking and the subtitles are appearing here by the side. They get highlighted for the sentence that he speaks. This is a technique which is very well established and we use YouTube in order to help us do this. You have to write a transcript, upload that transcript onto the YouTube. The YouTube will give you what is known as a .srt file. This is a methodology which Kalpana has just circulated, a 4-page note which describes how do you do that. Then you need to synchronize that transcripts with the video, and that synchronization, it can be done very easily. We have a team of TAs who do that work, and both Urmila and Vrinda are experts in doing this. You also have some other people who can do that. This is how the video will appear. Naturally, each one of you should design a short video and one of you should speak for 2 minutes and record that introductory video which will go into your course, which you will design. Now, this is important because for every course that will be offered, it is expected that an introductory video should be there as a part of the course description.
Anytime you want to skip this video and get a first-hand experience of the demonstration course, all you have to do is click week one to the left. Don't worry, I won't be offended. Let's first look along the top of the page. This area is called the navigation bar. Click on Courseware to interact with your course. Course info contains course announcements and updates from the course staff. If your course has digital textbooks, this is where you'll find them. Discussion is where you can communicate with the fellow students on topics and projects, and even occasionally with the course staff. When available, the course wiki acts as a knowledge base for your course. It's a helpful resource. Clicking on progress will reveal how well you are doing in your studies and exams. When you take the demo course, we'll provide you with a sample progress report matching your results. Let's look at the left column.
You saw those graphs. Every student is able to observe the progress made during the weeks through the quizzes, online quizzes that the student takes.
Now, the left side of the courseware screen contains a course navigation bar starting from the top down. Many courses start with an overview of edX and an introduction to the course. Below the overview are segments of the course, which are released as the course progresses. Typically, an edX course is delivered in week-by-week segments and have lessons and homeworks you need to complete. Many courses are 10 to 12 weeks long. We made this demonstration course 3 weeks for simplicity.
So this particular course is designed for 3-week duration, although we can complete the whole course in 2 hours. But this is just to demonstrate that a course can be organized in multiple weeks. There's a question that why should there be an end date for a course? So typically the course is defined globally, like we teach our paper. Our paper is one semester long or 1 year long or whatever. So many weeks of activities. Within each week, there are activities such as observe a lecture, do some activity, take an online quiz, take a practice quiz, take an exam, read some more. There could be multiple videos or whatever. All the things for 1 week will appear on a single bar like this. All the courses, all the 1 week's activities, all subunits within a unit will appear exactly like this. Let us continue listening to it.
Let's now look at the learning sequence. Each item in the left column reveals a corresponding learning sequence. Work your way from left to right. Learning sequences can contain lectures, exercises, and interactive lessons that you can complete on your own schedule. Next, let's discover what makes edX fun and unique, its interactivity. edX prides itself on its interactive lessons, which can include demonstrations, visualizations, and virtual environments. You can try out some in the demo course. Interactive lessons are often graded and contribute to your final grade. While the edX platform also supports more traditional question formats like multiple choice, our classes also test your understanding by allowing you to use labs and simulators, and even asking you to write an essay. Example of these graded interactions are in the demo course. You can see how the questions a course uses for gauging your learning process can even be auto-graded or detailed feedback given in real time. So while an edX course might be rigorous, the tools and visualizations are really fun and truly interactive. Finally, there are many ways successful students like you interact to get the most out of a course. Beyond the discussion forums, you can meet and engage with fellow classmates through a local meetup, which we highly recommend, a Google Hangout, or even invite students to join you via Twitter, Facebook, or other.
Google Hangout is a mechanism that is preferred by many EDX workers, where on the Hangout, people actually assemble together and discuss things. Eventually, we propose to integrate with our Indian platform another open source software developed by Amrita University called AVU, which is used for actual physical interaction between various nodes. The objective here is to offer contact centers of an open university, offer 300, 400 contact centers across the country, and say that for this course, on such and such Sunday, day 3 to 4, the teachers will be available for personal interaction, provided the students have submitted their questions in advance. So if they submit their questions in advance on email or something, or the questions which are raised during discussion forum on the course, you could actually, a teacher could filter out some important questions and personally address them. So because in India, like elsewhere, people still have some extra fancy for a teacher talking to me directly and hopefully interactively. I may not be always able to ask online questions, but I'll be able to at least interact. Now this is for future, but I'm just mentioning to you how I expect the platform to evolve over next 3 years. To meet various requirements. Currently, we're planning Google Hangouts, we're planning Facebook, and I think we're planning Twitter. These are the three things that we're planning. Currently, the linkages are being established.
YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter is banned in BHU. Access is not allowed to the students.
Okay. This is a good question, because globally, there's a full country which has banned YouTube, which is China. Now there are Chinese students who are taking our course, for example. For their benefit, what we have done is we have created a special kind of server called S3 located on the Amazon cloud. All the our videos which are there on YouTube, because YouTube connects to EDX automatically, we don't store videos on our server by the way. All your videos which you will upload onto the course will be uploaded on YouTube and a link will be there. So we actually provide a version of those videos onto that Amazon S3 server so that Chinese students can download those videos and do the course. Unfortunately, our observation is Very few Chinese are downloading, so God knows how they get access to YouTube wherever. But large number of Americans and European students are downloading and watching these videos whenever they want, independent of logging into this system. So that is a different story. But I am amazed that BHU bans YouTube.
Yeah, because the network speed and bandwidth is not so high, and I was discussing this with Dr. Lagu also. The second concern was that, means as you pointed out, if you have 1 lakh student and they are hitting the questions, how the 1 lakh questions are going to be answered by the teacher or that?
Okay, so that we'll discuss explicitly under running a course. So there is a separate session for that, but it's an important question. To answer you briefly, if the students increase linearly, the questions asked by them do not increase linearly. So if 30 students ask so many questions, 300 students will not ask 10 times more questions, 3,000 students do not ask 100 times more questions, and 3 lakh students do not ask so many times. We have a practical experience. My course has 58,000 students. I've been teaching that course for donkey's years in IIT. I can anticipate the questions that people will ask. I am also teaching that course as a teacher in IIT Bombay in blended mode. I have 500 students. The number of questions that these 500 students ask are not significantly different in quantity than the number of questions that 58,000 students ask. They are not thousands of times. There is a team of teaching assistants which tracks these courses. There is a difference between the questions which are asked in the classroom and questions which are asked on the MOOC. The question which is asked in the classroom are often synchronous. Sometimes in the night a student may ask a question which I can respond during the daytime. On the MOOCs, the students who are registered are from across the globe, and they would require immediate answer. So there has to be a team which monitors new questions every day. There is a team which must tell the teacher every day of which questions have become more complex or more common, which questions they have answered, and which questions they would like the teacher to answer. So for Gayathurne and me, the life is miserable because apart from doing our own normal work in the institute, we also have to cater to these requirements. We have good teams of TA, but anytime there is a flag, we'll have to sit down and prepare an answer and post it on the discussion forum. There is no shortcut to hard work in this. But you are right, there will be questions, but not as many as you.
It's a proven fact that if you engage with others while taking a course, you are more likely to succeed. Now that you've seen how easy it is to take an edX course, experience this demonstration course firsthand. All you have to do is click on week one to the left and you can get started.
I forgot to mention one thing. On the discussion forum, even that we find in a 530, 575 students class here, many good answers come very quickly from the students themselves. And in fact, if you have a lively discussion forum, you will be surprised that teacher does not have to intervene very often. Teacher just has to monitor. Good answers come from students almost universally, that is the experience. So this is one subunit, for example. I can go back to this course. Here are question styles. So these are the kind of quizzes I can create. I can, for example, create a picture. This is a picture, which animal is kitten? Suppose I click here and I say check, it says wrong. If I click here and I say check, it will say right. This is a simple exercise. If you go to, these are the settings for the unit. For example, this visibility is made public. That means it is available to any student in the LMS. Please note the two things. This is studio, the other is the learning management system. Whatever is made public here is visible in the learning management system, provided the start date, end date are proper. That means the date is passed. If I want to edit it, I will make it private. The moment I make it private, the edit buttons appear here. I can edit this question. Now, this is where some difficulty starts. This particular type of question is written in what we call an HTML script. Not all teachers will be familiar with HTML. That is the reason why you need a course team. which will take a text question from the teacher and code it in HTML. So to show you an example, this is a running course. You can see how one can take panga with this site. It's actually a live course. Course has just got over. But I have created a unit here called Swayam Trial. Now notice that word trial itself is wrongly spelled. It is scheduled to start on September 29, 2015. So it is visible to me in studio, but it is not visible to rest of the world. So I can do these kind of experiments on any place. Here are the sample quizzes. So here is one sample quiz. It is unpublished. This is actually loading from the regular site, okay? So notice what I have done. On which side of the picture do you see director of IIT Bombay? Now many of you would not know him. So suppose I click here and I say check, I'll get across. If I say click here and I say check, I'll get a right. If I say show answer, it will show a sort of window around this and say Professor Khakkar, director IIT Bombay, is on the right side of the image. On the left is Ron Mehta and illustrious Arnab Das. Now all this text is mine, this picture is mine, but the way to structure is exactly the same. Just to look at the editing, suppose I want to edit this. Now this portion was exactly as per the sample quiz, but here is on which side of the picture do you see director IIT Bombay. Why I am showing this at some length is because you will find that your teachers will not be averse to editing this after some experience. They can just write the text which replaces the original text. There will only be an issue in making a reference to your image file, which will have to be uploaded as part of the content, etc. All of that is fairly well documented. And you will in fact be doing some experiments. So I hope you have enough access to your own JPEG files or something. Someone on the team will have that access, so you will be able to do that.
Rectangular part.
Yeah, it is. In fact, if you see this HTML thing, it shows actually width and height of the image, and it shows the portion for the right answer. So rectangle starting with 340,1 extending up to 600,398 is the rectangle. If somebody clicks in that region, then that is the right answer. See, the software doesn't care for semantics of the right answer. So it wants a portion on the screen to be defined as right answer.
My point was, can we select, for example, I want to teach about camera in mass communication.
Yeah. Yeah.
Different parts of the camera are to be identified by the student.
Yeah. This one will, you can ask a quiz. You can say that which is the lens, for example. And then you can show the rectangle around the lens to be the right answer. So anybody who clicks somewhere else will get wrong, anybody who clicks there will get right. You can explore this further. There is another question here, for example, which is a math expression unit. So here the question is, give an equation for distance in terms of speed and time, explicitly indicate multiplication with a star symbol. I would expect an answer to be something like S multiplied by time as the equation. Notice that it automatically converts this into some expression, and when I say check, it says right S into. Now if you look at how this particular quiz has been made, again here is a problem. Okay, you put the problem between P and slash P. These are the typical tags on an HTML. Now this is the main part of the internal script which actually drives the quiz. So you give a proper, again you may, your team may need to be familiar with Python programming or some such tools in order to create quizzes of this kind. Ordinary multiple choice quizzes can be more easily created, which is what we often do. Here is a drag and drop example, for example, that you want to take match basically, how many three character word, etc., etc. Here is a drag and drop with outline, so you can label hydrogen items connected with left carbon item, whatever. Here is a circuit schematic builder. Why I am showing this, or these are shown in the original SWAM, is these are the kind of facilities which have been already built into the platform. Now obviously you will appreciate that the platform started with engineering and science courses, so many of the facilities are like that. Eventually I expect the contributions from all the universities will make this platform stronger, not only in terms of the courses that will go on it, but in terms of the additional back-end thing which will also go on. So that is the general object. Here is another drawing kind of thing. I can add any new component which can be only a HTML or a discussion or a problem, or I can insert a video here. So this is how I would actually create. This was an example of a sequence of subunits which were all quiz type questions. Incidentally, if I create 5 questions as 5 subunits, and let's say each question has 2 marks, then I can assign marks to every quiz, and the student after attempting all 5 questions can get a score out of 10. That is the simplest online examination that you can do. The standard recommendation, and we understand that recommendation, is that for every week there could be a series of videos. There could be some quizzes which are practice quizzes where the students get marks but they are not counted in their grade, and there could be graded quizzes. There could be additional explanations. Just to expand on what I see in the future, many of you would have heard of very good research on intelligent tutoring system or personalized tutoring system. This research has been going on for 30 years. That means based on the knowledge level of a particular student at any time, you can actually guide the student to study more material, do some more practice, so that you fill in the gap and try to bring every student up at the student's own pace. This was not feasible earlier because you could never get a feedback about every student instantly. Our feedback mechanisms were examination. Now that students are working online, it is possible for the system to note every individual student's status. And it is possible to write in future algorithms which will use these statistics to classify students in different categories and suggest that this set of students should need to learn this thing more. So they can be given an additional lesson, an additional unit, which is not required by a normal student. Variety of possibilities exist to make the learning experience better, but that will all come in future. When I say collapse all sections, you will see how the weeks are there. For each week, the various things are there. This is an actual course which is running, as I said, which is just finished. The courses that you will design will also look like this. And you can actually say, when I say View Live, when I click on View Live, please notice that I am on the studio.edge.edx. When I say View Live, I will go to the actual edge.edx site, which is the main site for the course. I forgot to mention this. I told you about 2 components. One is the learning management system, the other is the studio system. The entire set of these 2 things is copied and made available as an additional sandbox type of facility. Please note that if I design a course and by mistake, I am actually writing something for week 4, but by mistake I have set the date as say yesterday, then even my trial things will become visible to all the people who are watching the course. So to avoid that, another installation of the entire SWAM site will be made. We have not yet decided what name we will give. We will probably call it something like a sandbox or edge. Now that will be a system which will also have both the units, the studio and the learning management system. You would actually be designing your courses on that system. So that system, the studio, is actually private, but even LMS is private. So you can in fact experiment with it, see the LMS in a limited thing. You can, for example, decide to expose that LMS to say 50 students of your own course and just have volunteers to check it. Once that is done, you export that course out of that sandbox system, import it into the main SWAM, and then launch it. This is an additional backup that is available. We will be making that backup available. What you are seeing here is actually working on the edge, which is the clone version of the EDX platform. So we try this out here on the edge, then we import and export. The only problem here is I have done some course preparation, I have exported it and imported there. Now I want to make some modification. That modification I can make on the edge, but what I will have to export is the complete course. I can't export only a small modification. So you have to keep the courses in sync on both the clone sites if you so wish. Here is another thing I would like to quickly show. It is important that a national site for India should be visible both in English and in Indian languages. To begin with, we have decided that the main pages of the same site will be accessible in both the languages. So this is the main page of the Swayam thing. Here if I say preferred language and I can choose English, it will show English. If I say, you can see that these are actually the trial things that people have created. But I assure you that we do not have the pages yet translated into multiple Indian languages. And that will be a task that we'll have to do, especially when we deal with introductory courses, which are meant for first year students, undergraduate students, and certainly when we go to high school education. Now that is going to be a major activity in coming years. In our budgets, there is a budget for translation of course content also. There are two different things. What we are attempting is translation of the main pages of the Swayam platform, so that they are visible in multiple languages. So we saw, for example, one Hindi, if I save the language setting, now everything is available in this. If I go to, so you see the introductory page for the Swayam, somebody has already translated the title, but not the actual course page. Now, at least for the introductory courses that your university will offer, we expect you to give at least the introductory pages of the course in English and Hindi, and maybe as much material as you can actually get translated.
What do you mean? So say I am offering economics,
yes,
in English, can I offer it in Hindi as well?
Yes. In fact, we are still struggling to decide whether it should be called a separate course or it should be the same course. It is a messy thing. Mm. This is a feature which the platform does not have. So we have two choices. There is another advisor of ours, Professor Avinash Aute, is an industry person, an IITian only. He joined us back as an advisor for 10 years. So we are discussing how to implement this. One suggestion that he had is that we would have a main course, and we will have sister courses which are in different languages. So I could opt for a sister course, for example, where the contents would be same, but they would be in different languages.
Yeah. And I come to that introductory part, which translation version you are using? There is a scientific kind of dictionary created by this ministry. Are you using that scientific terminology or you are using?
I have specifically prohibited my translation teams from using anything which sounds legally correct or which is used by the ministries, because my own personal experience is that is not the language that common students understand. Forgive me if I am mistaken, but my observation is that the formal Hindi translation that emanates from government bodies is not easily palatable.
That is the problem with my subject. That's why I'm asking you, if I'll mention those terms in that language, nobody will understand.
Okay. We had an experience, Professor Gayatonde will share that with you. His course on thermodynamics, the name itself somebody translated as Ushma, what is that? Ushma Gatiki. Now, he said, Patak, you have studied in Hindi in Madhya Pradesh, so tell me what does this mean, Ushma Gatiki. So I tried to tell him thermal speed or something like that. Then he says, no, it is thermodynamics. Now, this is something, so what we have decided is a style which I saw in 1979-80 in Punjab, when they had prepared Gurumukhi books for training ITI students on using lathe machines. They called a lathe, they wrote Lath in Gurumukhi. First time when it appeared, they wrote L-A-T-H-E, and subsequently they used only Gurumukhi.
That means it should be translated in the popular words rather than in the...
That is correct. And additionally, we are saying technical words should not be translated.
That should not be translated.
Yes.
Steel plant has been translated in this Lohe Ka Pota.
We can actually have 4 or 5 hours of discussion on this topic. But we'll just have last word from Professor Gayathondi.
Anyway, I was going to bring this up tomorrow, but today it was asked. My thermodynamics is also getting translated into Hindi.
Yes.
Kiran Khosla's group. And I have provided a list of some 100 odd words, I think roughly 200 words, which should not be translated. They should only be transliterated. For example, temperature should remain temperature, energy should remain energy, and so
on. It is written in Devanagari. The point is that every student, Hindi speaking student, who is trying to understand thermodynamics will read and understand temperature if written in Devanagari, and will exactly understand what that temperature means. That is our feeling, but it is left to each individual university to decide what exactly they would do. This is, let us say, this is our opinion based on what we have fathomed. But it's a hard problem. The fact of life is Indian languages did not have contents of that kind so far. So it's not proper to expect those. In fact, if you see the European history, initially all countries of Europe borrowed from Greek and Latin. Subsequently, many countries borrowed from French. Those are all English words. It's very difficult to have that identity. Recently, I attended a show with Javed Akhtar, actually read out a series of 4 or 5 lines, apparently in Hindi, and then said, let us analyze every word. So he pointed out that these words are Turkish, udad he used, which is a Tamil word, it seems. And in the entire sentence, the only Hindi words were aya, gaya, and things like that. And yet he says every Hindi speaking person understands this complete sentence as a Hindi sentence. So that is one extreme of bolcha. Anyway, we digress. But this is a call that each university will have to take.
I may be wrong about this, but somewhere I read that every translated work is seen almost like another originative creative work. And it is taken different. I mean, it's the Hindi translation of a book is seen as another book. It's not just Hindi translation of book. So for our courses, we shouldn't have some nomenclature saying that, okay, this is this course and this is XYZ translation of this course. So we should say that it is another course. And we say that, no, it is a Hindi course. So somebody makes a choice saying that he's taking these courses, their courses in Hindi. So that is a different course. It's not, somewhere else you may have an equivalence table which says that this course which is in Hindi is equivalent to this course.
No, I don't agree with you for the simple reason. I again speak from my own domain. Introduction to computer programming is studied by all first year engineering students across the country, about 1.25 million students. The language of medium of instruction is English by definition, yet all interaction between students and teachers at 90% of the colleges happen in local languages. But the exams that they give, papers are in English, they answer in English. In fact, you have to answer in C or C++, which is neither English or something else. Now, if I give a course, and if I make my videos, subtitles, available in Hindi by translating those subtitles, if I make explanations in Hindi, but the code is entirely C++ code, same, is the same code, whether a student, we have this problem in IIT. There are 50 or 60 students every year who join IIT, BTEC, first, they are smart students. They can't understand English. So we arrange special lectures for them in Hindi. It is not a different course. It is exactly the same course because they have to give exactly the same exams. Exams are no different. So there could be an opinion on whether we should treat this as a different course, or we should simply say That is the same course explained in Indian language.
Okay. It is not so easy.
Again, it's a call that the university and the teachers have to take. I don't think we can formulate a general policy or any sense. At least that is my opinion. Yeah. Of course. I have another colleague, Professor Supratik Chakrabarty. He has two colleagues, Professor Milind Dattre and Professor Bhandarkar. You will meet them tomorrow briefly. There is, in fact, it is very dangerous to have only one teacher doing a course. Dangerous for the teacher himself or herself more than anybody else. A team is always better because there is always a backup, and then you can divide on the various topics. The only expectation is that the team should be synergetic. They should have a common passion, a common understanding of how things will proceed and so on. This is 1974. There was a tandem chess tournament. When Mr. Sakharkar and Shaigram, two top players of Maharashtra, were playing in tandem. There are 30 players against whom they are playing. So one fellow makes one move, another fellow then that opponent moves, another fellow makes one move. So these two people are making alternate moves. Can you understand how much synchronization should be there? In one particular place, Shaigram was an attacking player, moved his knight and offered for a sacrifice. The fellow was scared, okay, he did not take that knight. When Sakharkar came, he moved that knight back. One move wasted. That fellow played something. Shaigram came again, says what? He again put that knight back. This time that fellow took it. And that was the only game which they lost. So you can see what happens if the two people don't think synergetically. Sorry for digression, but the relationship between the faculty team has to be appropriate. I think that should be handled. Right.
Professor Phatak, I have a question.
Yeah.
How much in advance does the instructor need to prepare for the course, in the sense that if I start today, is the entire course content available to the student right at the beginning, or does it come only in parts?
Suppose the course is of a 2-week duration. And if I'm a student, I register for the course, ordinarily I will get to see only the first week. Till the week is passed, I will not see the second week. This is exactly like how we run a course in real life, a week-to-week course. A teacher would certainly indicate what are going to be the topics covered in week 2, week 3, week 4, when is going to be the exam, exactly like a normal course. But I would not see the second week. However, once I go to the second week, first week contents are also available for visualization. In fact, I didn't want to tell you this, but this is a fact that I have exploited significantly, because I could not complete my preparation for my course. Okay, so we are ahead of a running course just by a week sometimes. Now that is a very dangerous thing. Okay. The more organized people like Professor Gayatonde and all would have almost all their course ready before the course launches. I would expect most people in the country to be better organized. It's a very dangerous thing because, so I'll tell you one consequence. One quiz was delayed by 2 minutes for posting. It was to be announced on a certain date at 12 noon. This is the time which Professor Gayatonde picks for both our courses. 12 noon is 6:30 UTC. The time is not measured in Indian Standard Time, incidentally. It is measured as Universal Coordinated Time, UCT or something. So it is like Greenwich Mean Time, but the Americans don't like to refer to anything which is British, so they call it UCT, whatever. That's the name that we use. 2 minutes delay. And within 2 minutes, we had 10 these things on the discussion forum. Where is the quiz? It has not appeared yet in 2 minutes. So please understand that the reaction of the community could be very sharp. Indian students may not be as bold, but you will find that. Just remember this, whatever we do for a normal course of 100 to 500 students in our university, those rules do not apply when you engage 10,000 or 50,000 students, none of whom are under your direct control.
I think besides the number, internet is also an anonymized medium.
Yeah, internet is also.
You cannot be bold inside the class, but you can blast at you on the internet.
Yeah, that's
identity
right.
Identity is not known.
Yeah, yeah, identity is not known.
You
that is correct.
Four letter words all the time in the conversation, which will not use in the class.
By the way, I will mention this under the discussion, forum discussion. The moderated discussion has to be managed by your team. So there are actually instructions to participants. Please don't use offensive language. Please don't be personal. The whole lot of discipline that needs to be acquired by students. But yes, that is all right. So this is how I will design this example, week 1, week 2, week 3. If I wanted to add a new section, I could easily do that by saying, add a new section here. I can give the new section name. Let me just say it is week 4. Okay, and I save. Now notice that this week 4 has gone way here at the last. I can add a new subsection. Within that new subsection, I can add a unit. Within that unit, I can add a subunit. And I can keep on for every unit, I can define. There could be an HTML page, there could be a PDF file which I will upload and give a link. There could be any number of segments that you want. What I wanted to tell you is, primarily the objective of this, saying this is, that many times we get confused by saying that I have a course, I have a paper which I offer for 40 hours, and I have 40 hours of video recording, so my course is ready. My humble submission is absolutely nothing of that sort. The 40 hours of video recording is merely a starting point. And you have to actually plan the whole sequence of events that will unfold during a semester or a year when a student takes that course, including the weekly schedule. Cannot just have a 1 hour lecture. We have found from, and not we, but universally it has been found that people do not watch 1 hour lectures on the online courses. They typically watch 8 to 10 minute lectures. So to prepare conceptual package of 8 to 10 minutes out of a 1 year lecture itself is a big time activity for the teacher. It is not just video recording. You can't break a 1 hour record arbitrarily into 6 parts. You have to actually re-record every such thing into 10 minute thing. Although it is easier to prepare the transcript for the 10 minute thing and so on. And it is not that you put one after another these 10 units and say that is my week 1. After every unit of 10 minute lecture, you have to design some activity which the student should undertake, read something maybe, solve some practice problems, actually give a quiz, then go to the next 10 minutes. Now this is what is course design on the online course. And this is what actually takes maximum time. Yeah.
Can you have, can we have quizzes rather, which are not objective type, which actually they have to write something more than choosing bullet points?
That's a huge gross negative point of all online courses.
Okay.
Okay. The EDX platform permits what is known as ORA segment, which also we have actually kept as it is. Long answers can be given, but they cannot be automatically graded. So for automatic grading, there are two types of activities that are happening globally. One is research in machine learning, in which case artificial intelligence algorithms are used. The process is something as follows. Let's say I have 1 lakh submissions. Out of them, I will select 100 submissions and get them manually corrected and graded. And I will award grades. And in the process, I will award some key, I will allocate some keywords, etc., showing some weightages. Then I run that artificial intelligence learning algorithm with the feedback of the 100 evaluations, using which the system grades another 1,000. And those 1,000 also now, I will not grade independently, but I will evaluate what the machine grades are, and I will tweak them. And then it will automatically evaluate all 1 lakh. But it is very difficult to ensure that you get a human-like evaluation. So long answer evaluation is currently not possible. Yeah. So the second part is a peer assessment, which is available here on the EDX platform, and this can certainly be tried. In a peer assessment, I submit my essay type answer, and that essay type answer will go to a certain number of peers for their assessment. They will be randomly chosen. Similarly, I will have to participate in assessing some of the assignments submitted by peers. They have a very good formulation system. The feedback is that the peer assessment works pretty well, and teachers are confident that that is giving a fair assessment. Now, whether a university system would like to recognize marks obtained in that peer assessment or not, we do not know. That's a different question. But at least it gives a chance for both the teachers to ask long answer questions and for students to get some feedback. There is a peer assessment question in the demo thing also. So if you go to homework essays, for example, there is an assessment. So open response assessment, that is what is called ORA. The open response is a text that is submitted by people. So how does the peer grading work? There are three steps in this. First, answer the question, write a response to the prompt to the best of your ability. Then, contributing to the student community, grade other people's response. You will be provided by a rubric by the instructor and asked to evaluate how other people's response compared to that rubric. So that means, after you answer, you will get somebody else's answer to grade, and the teacher will say, okay, do you find this in the essay? Do you find this language used to be like this? So the actually questions, which is what I would have in mind as a teacher while evaluating somebody else's essay, those questions will be raised. And every grader, every participant will be asked to grade somebody's response. There is an example here. So there is a censorship in the libraries. Some paragraph is given. Okay. Read for conciseness, clarity of thought and form. Now you give your response here. The moment you type in your response, which is not a ABCD choice, it's a response. And then you can submit your response and move to the next step. Now, I don't want to steal the thunder. You can actually try it out when you do that. And then you will see that the system automatically gives you somebody else's response, asks you to evaluate and so on. How effective the whole thing is, frankly, we do not. For certain courses, such as a programming course, for example, auto graders have been built. Because when we teach programming, it's a practical course where people have to write working programs. So we don't want them to write English essays, but unless they can write long programs, there is no point. So we test their conceptual understanding through this. And in a blended MOOCs mode in the labs, they submit their assignments, which are tested by the teaching assistant. For the online course also, we have now constructed an online grader. So people, students are asked to write a program which they submit online. It's a file, but it's a program file. And that file automatically comes to our autograder. Autograder will check that and will allocate marks, and the marks can go to that person. Now this facility is tested. Why I mention this is, if you feel that you have an ability of automatically grading something which is a long answer, which you have written some programs at the back end to analyze some sentences and work things out, then it is possible in the SWAM platform to ask, to set a quiz saying, submit a text file. But you will have to write some code at the back end to get that text file to your auto grader, which is sitting on your machine, and it will automatically grade and supply marks back to you. So this feature is there, but to use that feature is not very easy. For any course specific requirement, you will have to build an auto grader, which is at best a tough proposition, but it can be done. Well, I would, rather than spending time in explaining things, I have just added this. I can delete it, by the way. I can move, suppose this is not week 4, I wanted this to appear between week 2 and week 3, I can call it week 2A and use this to move it up anywhere I want. So you see, week 4 has gone, between week one and week two. If I don't like it, I can delete it. The release date is given here. Section release date is this, release time. I can change this date and time. So this is the date and time on which this section will be visible to people. I can, of course, delete this week four which I have created. It asks me as delete, delete, gone. Yeah. What is the duration of? You can decide. You can say 28 weeks or 52 weeks. No, no. See, it depends on the kind of paper that you are teaching. If you ordinarily teach a paper for 1 year, then you would have to keep the course alive for 8 months. The global finding, statistical finding about the interest of the students is that if a course is longer than 6 to 8 weeks, more people drop out. But that is not yet proven thing, like many other statistics in the case of MOOC. You must also appreciate that a phenomena which is less than 3 years old in the whole world, whose history is of millions of years, and whose recorded human history is at least 10,000 years. 3 years is a minuscule time. I don't think generalized conclusions can be drawn on MOOCs at all. So you will read many papers which says MOOCs is a great thing, or you will read papers saying MOOCs is a failure. I think both extremes, it is too early to be judgmental about the whole phenomenon. So therefore, what is right and what is wrong, there are only some indicators. Just as I said, 4 minute or 5 minute, 8 minute video is an indicator. But we know, for example, that there are great orators amongst us in our world, where a teacher teaches for even 2 hours and people listen to that person spellbound. Now, if such a teacher is there and you say, no, 7 minutes, so that fellow will probably get bored. In fact, such great orators may take 7 minutes to tell the very introduction of the whole thing. They can't pack a concept. So I think you will have to take all such observations with a pinch of salt. The thumb rule is, statistically, people do not watch long videos. That is proven. Now within that, depending upon the course, depending upon the teacher, you will have to take a call and take it. And the No, in our universities there are 1 year papers, no? Or no, you are all 1 semester. Oh, all are 1 semester. Good. But even there we had a problem. For example, our courses are 1 semester and we insisted on a 13 or 14 week long course. We were advised by the forum that please don't do that. Break it into 2 portions. Say of 6 weeks each. I did that, which proved to be a fatal mistake. So I have 101.1x and 101.2x. First of all, the division is arbitrary. Second, I am forced to repeat some of the things at the end of the first course in the second course at the beginning. And third, the total duration is less than what I would have got. Professor Gayatonde completely refused to listen to that suggestion. He says, I don't care how many students take my course, but my course shall be of so many weeks. His course has a steady population of 20,000 who are still doing his assessments and so on. My course had a registered population of 58,000. I do not know how many will take my final exam, which was just released yesterday. So these are pros and cons. I think you will have to form your own judgment, which you will have to modify after one offering. Unless we offer it once, we do not know how it goes. And if the offering goes bad, it could be for a variety of reasons, not necessarily only one reason. So there should be surveys that should be part and parcel of your course. No survey will be done by the platform. It is not uncommon for many global courses that I have seen to build a survey in week before the start week. There is incidentally a facility that for all registered students, an email can be sent by the teacher at any point in time during the course, including before the course begins. So it is not uncommon to get emails on courses saying, your course is beginning next week, but we would like you to take this survey, which is published on the course site. The rest of the course is not visible, but the survey is visible. And you can get the results of this survey by which you can actually plan to modify some of your course options. So it is, to a large extent, it is similar to a course that we will normally run. If let's say Professor Gayatonde's course, which he has designed now, that course will be available. Next year he says, look, this course is open source, but I am not available to run it. Now let us say when Professor X from Mechanical Engineering Department says, I will offer that course. Now that Professor X has the complete freedom to modify that course as he pleases, because that will be a different offering. In fact, this is something which does not often happen in our university, but it happens routinely in institutions. It must be same thing in ISER. In IIT Bombay, one course is taught by 5 different teachers in 5 years. Each offering may be significantly different from other offerings. They are often different topics are covered with different emphasis. This is acceptable, this is respected also. What the course, any course must guarantee is that the basic concepts of that course are understood by everyone. The basic skills are understood by everyone. Beyond that, how to expand on a course is every individual faculty member's business. And it may so happen here. That is the reason why globally it is acknowledged that it is not the course name or the topic by which students selected. They also want to see who is the professor who is teaching that. So it's the combination of the course topic and the teacher which often is used by the students across the globe to decide what is. And of course, equally importantly, the name of the institution. So the more well-known is the name of the institution, more likely that the student may say, okay, this course may be good for. But what is universally proven is that the learner community wishes to get access to the best quality learning, not only in terms of content, but in terms of a properly run course of a, that much is. All right, so we'll stop.